और सर्विसेज बाय एन इंटरमीडियरी ऑफ फाइनेंशियल सर्विसेज विद एन IFSC इंटरनेशनल फाइनेंशियल सर्विस सेंटर लोकेटेड इन मल्टी सर्विसेज सेल्स टू अ कस्टमर लोकेटेड आउटसाइड इंडिया फॉर इंटरनेशनल फाइनेंशियल सर्विसेज इन करेंसीज अदर देन INR. What does this mean? There is the Gujarat International Financial Service Center. It is located in a special economic zone. So, what is the basic purpose of IFSC, International Financial Service Center, is to bring offshore services to the country for the betterment of the country. That means services like treasury management, international treaty drafting. So, all of these are generally carried out offshore. The government wants to bring these services within the country so that the country itself becomes more equipped. So what it does is it introduces a concept called IFSC. IFSC has a lot of benefits. It has a lot of infrastructure for these companies to operate. So let us say there is a stockbroker. A stockbroker is providing services to a foreign company. A stockbroker is taking, let us say, Microsoft's excess surplus funds and is investing somewhere. It is providing services to a person who is resident outside India. But the stockbroker is a registered person in India. He has a space in the IFSC. In that case, the service provided by the stockbroker to Microsoft for investing its funds anywhere in the world would be exempt. Services by an intermediary, the stockbroker of financial services with an IFSC. So he has a place set up in an IFSC located in, so this IFSC is located in a special economic zone to a customer located outside India for international financial services in currencies other than INR. So the amount, the consideration he receives in convertible foreign exchange or currencies other than Indian rupees. All right. So this would be exempt. The services provided by that stockbroker would be exempt. Normally, because this is in a special economic zone, this is not considered to be in India. This might be subject to tax, but therefore he exempted this. Now, services of life insurance provided by way of annuity under the National Pension Scheme, regulated by the Pension Fund Development Authority, Army Naval Air Force Group Insurance Funds to the respective members, Naval Group Insurance Fund, to the personnel of Coast Guard under the scheme of the central government. So any annuity payment made under the National Pension Scheme would be exempt. The life insurance services would be exempt. Similarly, the Army Naval Air Force has its own insurance funds. So some part of salary goes to this fund every month. On the death of this person, the bulk amount would be paid. So that is also exempt. The life insurance services provided by this fund to the army officers, naval, air force officers is exempt. So naval group insurance to the personnel of Coast Guard. Coast Guards are people who protect the borders of the country. They see that who is coming to India, who is, if any unauthorized person is coming into India, they catch hold of him and ask explanations. So they also have their own group insurance fund. So if this is set up under a scheme of the central government, even this, if I pay premium or if I receive a bulk amount, both of them are exempt from GST. Life insurance under the schemes of life micro insurance product approved by the IRDA having maximum cover of 2 lakh rupees. So life micro insurance product approved by the Insurance Regulatory Development Authority. This is a small micro insurance scheme where the sum insured is not exceeding 2 lakh rupees. So that is also exempt. So a list of schemes have been given. Janashri Bhima Yojana, Aam Aadmi, Varshita Pension, Pradhan Mantri Jeevan Jyoti. So whatever, whenever you see Pradhan Mantri, I think you can safely put an exemption there. Pradhan Mantri Vaya Vandan. So entry number 31, 31A, 31B, 32. Services by the Employee State Insurance Corporation, Employee Provident Fund Organization, Coleman's Provident Fund, NPS Trust, IRDA to its members. So the Employee Provident Fund Organization provides services to the employees for some administration fee. Even every monthly PF payment, when you see it is made, some admin charges will also be included. So that admin charges will not be subject to GST. That is nothing for the services provided by EPFO or ESIC to the employees or the employer organization. So this also would be exempt from GST. Services by SEBI. The basic purpose for which SEBI was formed is this: protecting the interests of the investors, promote the development of and regulate the securities market. If in respect of any of these services, SEBI charges a certain amount of consideration, so this is not subject to GST. Let us say I become a member of the SEBI. My company has made an application to become a member of an organization set up by SEBI. This is to regulate the securities market. The membership fee that I pay is also going for development of the securities market, because I am being a part of an organization which helps in promoting or regulating the securities market. So that is also would be exempt. Services of general insurance under various schemes like hut insurance, cattle insurance, and various list of schemes are exempt. Service of insurance of under the insurance scheme for tribals, universal health insurance scheme, are exempt, including reinsurance. So all of these insurance scheme, if an insurance company reinsures it with any other reinsurance company, so this also would be exempt. Not just the initial insurance, but reinsurance of this insurance would also be exempt. Here, this is a new amendment, the scheme of Bangla Shastra Bhima Yojana, which has been introduced only in the state of West Bengal for the people of West Bengal in order to ensure safety of their crops and all, would also be exempt. Service of collection of contribution under Atal Pension Yojana. Contribution monthly or periodically is collected, and at the end, pension is paid to the people who opt for the scheme. Collection of contribution under any pension scheme of the state government would also be exempt. Services by the following person: business facilitator, business correspondent to a banking company with respect to accounts in a rural branch. Any person as intermediary to a business facilitator or a business correspondent. Business facilitator or business correspondent to an insurance company. So who is a business facilitator and business correspondent? So in remote places in a village, it is difficult to set up a bank. It is not possible for SBI to set up a bank in each and every village and nook and corner of the country. So what it takes the help of business facilitators and business correspondents. What do these people do? These people register themselves as business correspondents and business facilitators. A business correspondent can act as a bank. He can accept deposits from the public. He can give loans, small loans to the public. And he can also let them withdraw money from him. Because there's no ATMs there, he will give money to the villagers. He will take money from the villagers. So he is literally acting as a bank for many of the banking transactions. What does a villager need? Basic transactions. So who is a business facilitator? A business facilitator cannot act as a bank, but he only facilitates the business of the bank. He finds customers for the bank. He finds people who need to open an account. But he cannot accept money, he cannot give money, or he cannot give loans. He only identifies people to whom loans can be given. So for that, he gets a little bit of commission. So does a business correspondent. For every account he opens or for every deposit that has been received by him, he gets a certain amount of commission. That is his incentive. So service provided by these people to the banking company. Bandhan Bank is a registered business facilitator. So Bandhan Bank provides service to SBI with respect to accounts in a rural branch. Opening accounts in a rural branch, this is also exempt. Any person as an intermediary, so the business facilitator or business correspondent, Bandhan Bank employs a few people to provide service to it. So these people provide service to the business facilitator himself. So that service is also exempt. Business facilitator or business correspondent to an insurance company. Similarly, an insurance company also, in villages, there is a lack of awareness in respect of agricultural insurance. So in order to promote the awareness, and to get insurance policies, business facilitators and business correspondents are put in place by the insurance company. So this service provided is also exempt. Services to central government, state government under any insurance scheme or training program where the entire premium is borne by the central government, state government. So let us say the central government for one of its department, let us say the Ministry of Health, insures all its employees under a group insurance policy with the United Insurance India. So this amount paid by the central government or state government to United India Insurance is exempt because it is a service provided to the central government by any insurance scheme, under any insurance scheme provided by a private party. So services provided by GSTN to the central government, state government, union territory for implementation of GST is exempt. GSTN is a Section 8 company which provides services to the central government, state government for running the GST network. To be precise, it runs the GST portal. Service provided by fair price shops to central government, state government, union territory by sale of essential items under public distribution scheme for consideration and commission. So the ration shops provide essential commodities at a discounted price. So all these products are supplied to the ration shop by the government itself. These fair price shops or ration shops get a certain amount of commission on the goods sold by them. So this commission charged by these fair price shops or ration shops is also exempt. Now, service of long-term lease of industrial plots for more than 30 years for development of infrastructure or for financial business supplied by Industrial Infrastructure Corporation undertaking or any other entity in which central government or state government has ownership of 50% or more to industrial units or developers in any industrial or financial business area, the exemption is admissible only if the amount is decided upfront. So what does this mean? Long-term lease of land. The Telangana State Industrial Infrastructure Corporation gives land on an application made to it for carrying out, for setting up a manufacturing facility or for setting up a trading facility or setting up any kind of business. If you make an application, it gives you land on long-term lease. So for that, you need to pay an upfront amount, either bulk amount or you can make a payment periodically. As long as the amount that is payable either periodically or upfront is determined initially itself, it would get an exemption. The amount payable is not subject to GST. So to whom is this exemption applicable? It is applicable in case of long-term lease for a period of more than 30 years given by an industrial infrastructure corporation like the TSIIC or any of the undertaking of the government in which the government holds 50% or more of the ownership. So if any such undertaking gives long-term lease, it would be exempt. Even if the Industrial Infrastructure Corporation gives, it is exempt. Leasing of assets, rolling stock of assets by the Indian Railways Finance Corporation to the Indian Railways. So the station wagons, the bogies and engines are rented by the Indian Railways Finance Corporation to the railways, let us say IRCTC. So in this case, the service of leasing is exempt. Service by way of sponsorship in respect of sporting events conducted by the National Sports Federation or affiliated federations where participating teams represent a district, state, zone or country. Association of Indian Universities, Inter-University Sports Board, School Games Federation of India, All India Sports Council for the Deaf Paralympic Committee of India. By the Central Civil Services Cultural and Sports Board as part of the National Games by the Indian Olympic Association under the Panchayat Yuva Krida or Khel Abhiyan scheme. So what does this mean? In respect of a sporting event conducted by any of these recognized sports bodies, if a recognized sports body conducts any of the events and for that event, let us say Tata Group is sponsoring. So that sponsorship service would be exempt and would not be subject to GST. Sponsorship service is subject to GST under reverse charge, remember. So the person receiving the service, Tata, would be subject to pay tax. But it would be exempt if it is in respect of a recognized sports body conducting the event. National Sports Federation of India, affiliated federations, the state federations, where the participating teams represent a state, district, zone or country, if it is an international game that is being conducted by the National Sports Federation, then it would be exempt. Association of Indian Universities. The universities have inter-university boards, sports boards. So they conduct cricket tournaments every year or even for every semester. School Games Federation, the All India School Games Federation is there. All India Sports Council for the deaf. If during school times also, if you look at cricket, there is a tournament that happens inter-school right from childhood. So that, if it is conducted by the any of these sports boards, it would be exempt. If it is conducted by the Indian Sports Council for the deaf, for the people who are deaf, then it would be exempt. Paralympic, people who are disabled, if the Paralympic Committee of India organizes any kind of sports event, it would be exempt. So the civil services officers have their own sports board. So if any event is conducted countrywide by that board, it would be exempt. The Indian Olympic Association conducts any of the national games, that is also exempt. Any event conducted under the Panchayat Yuva Krida or Khel Abhiyan scheme, all of these are recognized sports boards, sports bodies conducting sporting events. It would be a recognized sporting event. The sponsorship for these would be exempt. Now, let us look at legal services. Simple. Legal services, services by an arbitral tribunal, legal services by an individual advocate, firm, senior advocate to a business entity with an aggregate turnover in the preceding year, which makes it eligible for exemption under from registration under the GST law. Any person other than business entity. Central government, state government, union territory, local authority, governmental authority and government entity. So, an arbitral tribunal, if it provides any service to any business entity which is not required to register itself because its turnover in the preceding financial year has not crossed the 20 lakhs or 1.5 crores as the case may be. It is not required to register itself. And to a person other than a business entity, an individual, let us say, who is not carrying on business, a personal, a civil case it is, that is also not subject to GST. The lawyer should not charge GST. So if it is provided to the central government, state government, local authority, let us say the government takes advice from a lawyer in respect of making changes in the constitution. So that service is also not subject to GST. So remember the fine lines, any service by an arbitral tribunal and only legal service by individual advocate, firm of advocate, senior advocate. Who is a senior advocate? A senior advocate is given that status by the bar council of that respective state. Considering his experience in any branch of law, he has a tag put on his black coat. You can easily distinguish who a senior advocate is. So one more difference is, it is the same for an individual, a firm of advocates and a senior advocate. So all of these three are exempt if provided by any of these three. But for an individual or a firm of advocates, the only difference is, even if it provides service to another individual or firm of advocates, it would be exempt. But if a senior advocate provides service to an individual firm or firm of advocates, it would be taxable. But for an individual advocate or firm of advocates, even if it provides service to another individual or firm of advocates, it would be exempt from GST. So that is the only difference. For the remaining, it is the same for all. If I provide service to a business entity not required to register itself, exempt. A normal individual who is not a business entity, exempt. Central government, state government, local authority, governmental authority, government entity, exempt. All right. Next, renting of residential dwelling for use as resident. The usage should also be for resident. If I use a residential complex for commerce purpose, for setting up my office, so then this exemption would not apply. It is hard to find out, but that is a different issue. Service by hotel in guest house, club, campsite for residential or lodging purpose of value of 1000 or less. Previously it was only if it was less than 1000 the exemption would be available. Now even if it is a round figure of 1000 rupees, it would be exempt from GST. So this is brought in order to ensure that just for that 1 rupee, that is why the hotels were charging 950 rupees. So in order to make it a round figure, they even included 1000 rupees for giving the exemption. So previously it was if the consideration was less than 1000, the exemption would be available. Now even if the consideration is a round figure of 1000 rupees, the exemption from GST is still available. Service by transportation of goods by aircraft from a place outside India up to the custom station of clearance in India. So this is to give exemption to local transporters. Let us say a logistics person is there. It transports goods from a place outside India to India. So he would be subject to GST. Because the location of supplier or service is in India, the place of supply, even though if it is outside India, the amount is not being received in convertible foreign exchange. So this would not make it an export of service and it would be subject to GST. So but if it was a foreign transporter, he would get the exemption because it would be outside the GST purview. So in order to make things even, so even the local transporters are now being given exemption. Service of transportation of goods by aircraft from a place outside India up to the custom station of clearance in India is exempt. Service by transportation of goods by aircraft or vessel from custom station of clearance in India. So from India to any other place also, the foreign transporter was getting the benefit. He was not being subject to GST because it would come under export most of the cases. So in order to give benefit to the local transporter also, the exemption has been provided. Now the benefit was there, I think, up to March 2020. It has been extended to 30th September 2020. Services by giving on hire to a state transport undertaking a motor vehicle meant to carry more than 12 passengers. So let us say the Telangana TSRTC takes on rent from any private operator a few buses. So it would be exempt. So services, a goods transport agency issuing a consignment note making transport of goods by road, if it takes on rent any motor vehicle, let us say it takes a transport van on rent, so that also would be exempt. Motor vehicles for transport of students, faculty, staff to a person providing transportation of students, faculty, staff to an educational institution providing service by way of preschool education and education up to higher secondary school or equivalent. So if you remember, service of transportation of students, faculty, of staff provided to an educational institution up to intermediate was exempt. So if that person providing service to the educational institution takes a bus on rent from someone else, so that renting of bus would also be exempt. So I'm exempting the entire chain so that there's no burden on this precious service of education. All right. Now, this is a new amendment. Electric vehicles to a local authority to carry more than 12 passengers is exempt. So if giving hire of electric vehicles, which are meant to carry more than 12 passengers to a local authority have been made exempt. I don't know why it is only restricted to only a local authority. Now, services by way of access to road bridge on payment of toll. So the toll charges generally would be subject to tax, but the fast tag that you pay, which is now in boom for collection of toll charges, you are only paying the toll charges, there is no GST being levied. Maybe on the service charges provided by the respective bank for issuing a fast tag, on that GST would be levied, but not on toll charges. Service by transmission and distribution of electricity by an electricity transmission and distribution utility. Simple application fee for releasing connection rent. Okay. So the Telangana State Power Corporation transmits and distributes electricity. So that service provided to a common customer would be exempt. Whether you are commercial or not, it would still be exempt. But remember, when you apply for a connection, some service charge is levied. So that is taxable. Renting charges for the meter that is installed in your house or office is taxable. For testing the meter and testing your connection periodically, some charges are levied. That is also chargeable to tax, GST. So if you want to shift your electrical connection from one place to another place within the city, that is also subject to GST. If you lost your electricity bill and you want to duplicate bill, some amount is charged on you. So that is also subject to GST. The only thing that is exempt is the basic services of transmission and distribution of electricity. Only that service is exempt. Service by an incubatee up to 50 lakhs in a financial year. Provided your turnover in the last year does not exceed 50 lakhs, a period of 3 years has not elapsed from the date of entering into an agreement. So who is an incubatee? Look at this, a person located within the premises of a technology business incubator or software technology and electronics park recognized by the National Science and Technology Entrepreneurship Development Board, who has entered into an agreement to develop high-tech and innovative products. So these IITs and all, they have incredibly skilled people. So some people might have an idea of making a startup. So what they do, there are incubators around the IIT area, so which fund the startup idea. So these business incubators, they are recognized by the National Science and Technology Entrepreneurship Development Board. So those incubators, if they provide services to a startups called incubatees, and the startup makes a turnover of up to 50 lakhs, then even though it is crossing 20 lakhs, it is subject to GST. Still, it would be exempt because it is an incubatee with a technology business incubator or STEP. It will not be subject to GST on the turnover that it makes up to 50 lakhs, provided the last year turnover in the preceding financial year does not exceed 50 lakhs and 3 years has not elapsed from the date of entry into an agreement as an incubatee. So the initial 3 years, for 3 years only, it is subject to exemption. For after the initial 3 years, there is no exemption. All right. This is what is services by Food Safety Authority of India to food business operators like licensing, registration, analysis, or testing of food samples. What does this mean? If you are running a food business on Swiggy, you are required to compulsorily take an FSSAI registration. Otherwise, he will not let you put your business on Swiggy. So this FSAI for taking registration charges you a nominal amount for registration and license. It also sometimes, if your business is big and it requires testing, comes and tests your food samples. So this amount charged is exempt from GST. Service by TBI are exempt. So as we discussed, the service provided by the business incubator to the incubatee is exempt. Service of collecting or providing news by independent journalist. So independent journalist collects news and gives it to the PTI or the news agencies. It is exempt. The Press Trust of India, United News India, service of public libraries by way of lending of books. So if you take books from the British Council and do not return back, the late fee levied by it would be exempt. The lending fee, which keeps on piling up if you don't return the book back, is also exempt. Publication or any other knowledge enhancing content. Okay. Service by of organizing to a person in respect of business exhibition held outside India. So let us say I have created a new software idea, or I have some unique product, handicrafts. I want to sell it in the United States. So what I do is I conduct a business exhibition outside India. So I take the help of an event manager for conducting this business exhibition outside India. So the service of organizing this business exhibition outside India would be exempt. If this exemption was not there, it would be taxable because the location of supplier of service is India, Indian. The event management company is an Indian one. The place of supply would also be where the location of registered person is, that is India. So it would be subject to GST. So I do not want this to happen because the event is actually taking place outside India. So I exempt if the business exhibition is being carried out outside India. Service by way of preconditioning, pre-cooling, ripening, waxing, retail packing, labeling of fruits, vegetables, which do not change the characteristics. So for preservation of the fruit, some waxing is done. So if you buy an apple from a supermarket, if you rub it with your knuckles or fingernails, you will find some wax on it. So you have to properly clean it. That waxing done is exempt. Preconditioning, cooling is done. Artificial ripening is done sometimes in order to make it ready for sale quickly. Packing is done. So all of these are not changing the characteristics of, let us take a mango for example. In order to make it ripen quickly, I am using some kind of process. So that is not altering the essential character of a mango. If I am cutting the mango and making a juice out of it, that is altering the character. Or if I'm just packing it, so because it is not changing the essential characteristics, it would be exempt. Service by National Center for Cold Chain Development by way of cold chain knowledge dissemination. So this National Center for Cold Chain Development, the main objective is to enhance the quality of cold chain storage. So the knowledge that it disperses for some consideration, or the facilities that it imparts or services that it provides in the form of consultancy would be exempt. Service by foreign diplomatic mission in India. The Iran consulate, if it provides any kind of service, then it is exempt. To an Iran national in India, it would be exempt. Service by way of providing information under the RTI. The students of the ICAI have asked ICAI to give the mode of evaluation. So under the RTI Act, one student has asked. So that service provided by under the RTI for nominal charges would also be exempt. Services to a recognized sports body by an individual as a player, referee, coach, team manager for participation in a sporting event organized by a recognized sports body. All right. So, what does this mean? A recognized sports body first. It has to be a recognized sports body. What is a recognized sports body? As we have discussed, the National Sports Federation of India, the Board of Control for Cricket in India, any sport regulating body, inter-college boards, all of those are recognized sports bodies. The Hockey Federation. So, to these, if any person provides, any individual provides services, a player, referee, coach, team manager for participating in a sporting event organized by the recognized sports body. All right, this recognized sports body has to organize this sporting event. So if you look at this, only people who are visible on screen are given the exemption. Who are visible? The player is on the field, referee is on the field, coach is visible, team manager is visible. All right. So those people, the services that they provide has been exempt. So if the recognized sports body, if let us say the Hockey India Federation provides service to, let us say the Pakistan's Hockey Federation, it provides some consultancy, or let us say the one state hockey federation provides service to another state hockey federation, it is also exempt. But services of selectors, commentators who are backstaff, Q curators, technical experts are taxable. I don't know why these people have been subject to tax. It is a mystery, but they are. Services by operators of common biomedical waste treatment facility. So the hospitals generate a lot of biomedical waste, which could be recycled or which could be converted into something useful. So some organization exclusively carry out this service of treating this biomedical waste. They have this waste treatment facility. So if the service is provided to a clinical establishment by way of disposal of biomedical waste or process incidental thereto, public conveniences, this is self-explanatory. So service by an artist by way of performance of folk or classical art forms of music, dance, theater. What does this mean? It has to be under classic or folk art forms. It cannot be Western music. Folk means Bharatanatyam, folk dance is there. Classical dance is Bharatanatyam, Kuchipudi. Folk artists are there. It is just not sufficient if it is folk or classical art forms. It has to fall under any of these three. Music, dance, art, theater. So if it is a classical art, but it is a painting, it is not subject to this exemption. All right. It has to be in relation to music, dance and theater. All right. But the consideration should not be more than 1,50,000 per performance. If today, let us say, Shobana carries out a dance performance in Mumbai and she charges around 3 lakh rupees for that night. So it is not exempt because the consideration is more than 1,50,000. But if she charges 1 lakh for that night of performance, then it would be covered under the exemption. Because is it a classical art form? Yes, Bharatanatyam. Is it under any of these art forms? It is dance. Yes. So let us say Sufi singer sings a song. So is it a classical art form? I don't know if a Sufi comes under, if it is classical art form, it is music, then it would be exempt if that consideration is less than 1,50,000. It is not applicable if Shobana just comes to a Britannia, a conference organized by Britannia and performs there, if she is the brand ambassador of Britannia. If she is actually the brand ambassador and she just comes there on behalf of Britannia, the consideration that she charges is not exempt. Because she is coming there not for performing, her main motive is to promote Britannia biscuits. Service by way of admission to a museum, national park, wildlife sanctuary, tiger reserve, zoo. So we know what this is. It is exempt. Protected monument. So what are some of the protected monuments? Taj Mahal. So admission to protected monument declared so by the legislation is exempt. So admission to circus, dance, theatrical performance including drama, ballet. Now look at DEF quickly. Award function, concert, pageant, musical performance or any other sporting event, other recognized sporting event. Recognized sporting event, planetarium. If the consideration does not exceed 500 per person, what is a recognized sporting event? Let us say an Indian cricket match is happening. It is a recognized sporting event because it is conducted by a recognized sports body, BCCI. So if the consideration for some of the seats is 500 or less, then that ticket would be exempt. If it is more than 500, it is subject to GST. So Birla Planetarium is there. Admission would be exempt if it is ticket value is less than 500 or equal to 500. Alright, similarly for an award function, pageant, musical performance or any other sporting event. Services received from a person located in non-taxable territory by the central government, state government or individual for any purpose other than trade, commerce, industry. So this is for import of services covered under the IGST law. So normally import of service, even though it is not in the course of furtherance of business, would be subject to tax. All right. But here he says that he gives the exemption. Import of service by the central government, state government, local authority or an individual for purpose other than trade, commerce, industry is exempt. So, import of service by an entity registered under 12AA of the Income Tax Act for the purpose of providing charitable purpose activities. So, a charitable organization, let us say it is providing education for the poor, it imports certain kind of technological equipment for providing better educational infrastructure, like it imports online online drawing boards for the purpose of better presentation. So this is exempt because it is imported by a charitable institution and it is for charitable activities. The charitable activities not under the Income Tax Act, but it should be under the GST law. Charitable activities, we've already discussed three: education, environment, health, and religion. So, supply of online educational journals to an educational institution other than institution providing preschool education and education up to higher secondary school and education as part of a vocational educational course. So, if we remember, supply of journals online is exempt only for an educational institution other than educational institution providing education by way of school or intermediate. So, for a school or intermediate college, periodicals or online journals supplied are subject to tax. So, the same thing is being followed here. So, supply of online journal from any other country, this being an import of service, would be subject to tax. However, it has been exempt provided it is not for a school or intermediate college. So, import of service by a person located in non-taxable territory. So, it is being imported by the journal, the service is being provided to a person located in any other country, but maybe he has made the payment from India. A person from India has made the payment. So, in that case, the import of service would still be exempt. So, this ABC is not applicable in case of OIDR service provider. Exemption also not available in case of transportation of goods received by a person. So, this is also not applicable in case of transportation of goods. So, import of goods also includes transportation of goods, right? So, those have been specifically covered under the previous exemption entries that we've discussed. So, for that kind of import of service, this entry is not applicable. So, ultimately, to put it, import of service by central government, state government, local authority, or any individual for that matter, for non-business purpose is exempt. By a charitable institution for charitable activities is exempt. Online journal, if it is or periodicals, if it is imported, that services, if it is imported, then that is also exempt if it is not provided to a school or intermediate college. Other than that, it would be exempt. Even if it is provided to a non-taxable person in non-taxable territory, it is exempt. Services by RBI from outside India in relation to management of forex reserves, exempt. Service by tour operator to a foreign tourist in respect of tour conducted outside India. Let us say an Indian tourist operator provides service to a person in US for taking him to Sri Lanka. So, the person who is receiving the service is outside India. The tour is also being conducted in somewhere else, not in India. So, I need to exempt this. So, that is why this exemption notification has been given. Service by tour operator to a foreign tourist in respect of tour conducted wholly outside India. Service provided by an establishment of a person in India to any establishment of that person outside India, which are treated as establishments of distinct persons, provided supply of services outside India. What does this mean? So, it means that, let us say I am a software company, I have another branch outside India. Any service provided by me to that other entity would be supply between distinct persons and it would be it would not be an export of service, because export of service clearly excludes supply between distinct persons. All right. So then it would be subject to GST. So in order to exempt this, I have brought entry number 4 under the IGST notification. So services by this software company to any of its branch outside India would be exempt. It is not export of service, because if you look at the definition of export of service, it clearly excludes supply between distinct persons. All right. Now, import of service by the UN or any specified international organization for official use of the UN or the specified international organization. So what does this mean? What is a specified international organization? One of the specified international organization is the World Health Organization. So World Health Organization has its one of its agency or branch in India also. So if WHO imports services from a doctor of the UK, that is exempt. It takes technical help from a person outside India, that is exempt. If it is used for official purpose, the purpose for which WHO has been set up. Now, import of service by foreign diplomatic mission or consular post in India, or diplomatic agents or career counselor officers posted, shall be exempt from IGST. So, if a foreign diplomatic mission, let us say the US consulate is there in India for taking the grievances of US nationals who reside in India. So, the import of services by the US consulate in India is exempt, provided exemption has to be clearly specified in the certificate issued by the protocol division of the Ministry of External Affairs on the basis of principle of reciprocity. What does this mean? In the Indian consulate in the US, for the Indian consulate, the same exemption has to be provided by the United States. If that is provided, then India will also provide exemption to the US consulate. So that is what the principle of reciprocity is. So the certificate issued by the Ministry of External Affairs has to clearly state that the import of service by the foreign diplomatic mission or consular post in India is exempt. And the services are used for official purpose of the diplomatic mission or consular office. Understand? Or for, so these two are offices. So these are people who work in these offices, diplomatic agents or career consular officers. So if these individuals who hold a post in the diplomatic mission or consular post in India, these people import some kind of service from outside India, it is also exempt. In their personal capacity also, if they import service, that is also exempt, provided they use it for their personal use. Even if it is used for the members of their family in India, it is also exempt. In case the Ministry of External Affairs withdraws its certificate, it shall be communicated to the person. The exemption from IGST shall not be available from the date of withdrawal of such certificate. Understood? So ultimately, a certificate has to be obtained by the diplomatic mission or consular office. Based on the reciprocity, the certificate is issued by the Ministry of External Affairs, and it has to be used for official purpose of the foreign diplomatic mission or consular office, or that individual in his personal capacity. If it withdraws the certificate, the exemption is no longer available. Now, import of services by a unit or developer of a SEZ unit are exempt from IGST. So, if I import a service, it would be subject to IGST. So, because it is being imported by special economic zone, which is for the benefit of encouraging exports, what an SEZ unit does, it exports. In order to encourage exports, I have to exempt all the imports made by the SEZ unit. So, that is what is being done. Import of service by a unit or developer of SEZ are exempt. IGST payable under 3 subsection 7 attributable to royalty and license fee included in the transaction value of customs valuation is exempt. So let us say I import certain goods. All right. Let us say 5 lakh worth of some computer equipment I import. So this computer equipment has some specific design in such a way that some royalty is being paid to that manufacturer. That is also included in the import value. All right, the CIF value also includes the amount paid for royalty. So this is, in a way, I am importing goods as well as importing service of this royalty. So import of service would also attract IGST. Already import of goods, I am actually paying IGST. This would amount to double taxation. So in order to avoid this, what I do is IGST payable on the consideration attributable to royalty and license fee included in the transaction value of the customs valuation is exempt. All right. So this concludes our exemption discussion.